It's one of which we need to fully understand because it concerns our spiritual salvation and our spiritual nature. So let's begin in the beginning. Genesis 2:29. I'm going to show you the first four instances of the word naked in the Bible. Now, a lot of people are probably already have, well, maybe down south they don't, but I said the word naked.
That's right.
Now, I did have folks, I was teaching when I was over in Kwajalein, Republic of Marshall Islands, and I said, naked, and the guy said, do you mean naked? And I said, now, where I'm from, naked is what you are without your clothes. Naked is something you're not supposed to be watching or anything. There's a difference. But again, when I say naked, I mean you don't have any clothes on. So let me clarify that from the start. So Genesis 2:25. They were both naked, and man and wife, and they were not ashamed. Well, that's an interesting statement right there. And of course, we're talking about Adam and Eve. We look at this sentence, and it looks like the natural thing to do is when you are naked, you are supposed to be ashamed, doesn't it? That's what it looks like. They were not ashamed. Now, why were they not ashamed? It's interesting. You'll see the word naked, 97 verses in the Bible. So it's a pretty heavy topic in there. And you'll also see shame in there, 203 times. So these are topics we're going to see all throughout the Bible. But this is the first instance those words are ever used. Now, being naked is a physical thing. You either are or you aren't naked. So it's something that has no real, you know, moral statement about it. You're just naked and don't have clothes. Now, what happens is we also have here the word ashamed. And the shame comes from a person's soul and their spirit, their heart, on how they view the nakedness. So we have this dichotomy here of we have naked and we have ashamed. What is that relationship? And we're going to explore that relationship. So how can it be that we have this thing going on? How can you be naked and not ashamed? Let me balance that a little bit. It's like it's a little off. That better?
Yeah.
Because you don't want to be naked and crooked. Gotta keep that squared away. How can it be that you are naked and ashamed and there's no issues there? Well, it's because you're in the bosom of Jesus Christ, God, the Trinity, here in the Garden of Eden, where there was perfection, where there was a place made where all the desires and wants of that man and woman were met, living in perfect harmony and union with God. So they're in the bosom of Jesus Christ, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit, all communion. But it didn't last long. Well, we really don't know how long it lasted. It lasted. But because Satan entered into the equation and he tempted Eve, and they both, Adam and Eve, ate of that fruit. Now we're not going to get into all that blame game discussion, but we will read the next verse, which has nakedness, Genesis 3:7. And the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, there's a lot going on right there. Their eyes were open. Why? Because they ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So there was something unlocked at that time within their psyche, within their minds. And they all of a sudden knew that they were naked. And what did they do? They immediately sewed upon themselves fig leaves as aprons. Now, apron doesn't cover your whole body, so we can pretty much imagine what the thoughts going through their minds were at this time. But for the first time, mankind was spiritually naked before God. And Adam and Eve were immediately overwhelmed by their self-consciousness of who they were and their self-centered nature, and their thoughts took over and their desires enter into their souls for the first time. And Satan, I'm sure, did not stop. But at this time, Adam and Eve had Satan's fiery darts being shot at them. All kinds of things. And what protection did Adam and Eve have? None. They were the first humans that ever had to deal with the sin nature that was within them bubbling up and overriding their thoughts. I feel sorry for Adam and Eve at this time because of the nature and the relentless pursuit that Satan would have on them at this time. And they tried. They tried physically to have an outward means by which they could cover themselves. But it was a spiritual thing that they were dealing with. But they were trying to cover it, their thoughts, these new emotions, these new feelings that they were dealing with. They were trying to cover whatever they could find. Now we move on to the next two instances of nakedness. And this is in Genesis 3:10. And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, this is Adam speaking, because I was naked and I hid myself. Now, there's a lot of interesting things going on there. And he, this is God, who told, and God said, who told thee thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou should not eat? And here we find another word for the first time in the Bible. It's afraid. And the nakedness came first, and then he was afraid. This afraid shows up about 200 times in the Bible. And this is how we deal with this. Here, they were spiritually naked and afraid before the Lord God who created them. Again, they were trying to find some place to hide. Now imagine that. How do you hide from God? Anybody figure that one out?
Can't do it.
You can't do it. There's not a good chance, is there? God pretty much knows everything. He's omniscient. He knows everything there is. He knows where you're at. So can you really ever hide from God? Couldn't then? Can't now. A lot of people try. Where do we do most of the sins that you think about people doing sins? In the dark. Why? God can't see it. Well, no, not really. He can see everything. Okay? So here they were. They were naked, spiritually raw before God. And God saw their thoughts and they knew it. And their thoughts were not the nice thoughts that they had previously had. They were having to deal with this. And then we move on. We've got to move on quick. There's a lot going on. Genesis 3:21. Unto Adam also and his wife did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothe them. First time we have clothes mentioned in the Bible. And the Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us. Now notice God said us. So it's the Trinity working in harmony here. You have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You have Lord God. And that Lord God, if you look at that word, it is Jehovah, which is the great I Am. And that is who Jesus Christ is here. Jesus Christ is a physical manifestation of God that presents himself before mankind. Was then, is now, has not changed. To know good and evil now, lest he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Now God had mercy upon mankind by expelling him, by driving him out, by casting him out. Because at that time, if mankind, Adam and Eve, would have eaten of the tree of life, they would have been eternally separated from God. God did not want that to occur, so he cast them out to deal with this naked nature that they now had, exposed before God, and the fear associated with that. And that is the state that we still see today. So from the beginning, God intervened with mankind. Now notice here, they didn't keep the aprons, but what did God cover them with? He made coats of skin, and he clothed them. So that by itself shows that God had to perform some kind of a sacrifice of blood to show that blood was necessary for the atonement of sin. The only way sin is atoned for is by a blood sacrifice. And God performed the first blood sacrifice in order to be able to cover their sins. And notice here, he made coats of skin. It wasn't just an apron. So it was covering them bodily. So God alone, and mankind has a hard time still understanding this, man cannot cover their own sins before a righteous God. God alone can repair, reconcile, atone for the brokenness of mankind. That hasn't changed since Genesis. Still in effect. Now I'm moving on. We're going to cover the whole Bible, so I'm going on to a piece of time between Genesis and the law ended. I'm going to cover that whole period here. I'm going to do it fairly quick. 1 Samuel 16:7, it's critical for us to know this as Christians. God focuses not on the nakedness of our flesh, but he focuses on the spirit. He doesn't focus on our body. That's not the critical aspect God considers when he looks down upon each and every one of us. He looks at within, in the spirit. And I say that because of 1 Samuel 16, this of course is where Samuel is going to visit Jesse and see his sons and pick out the next king of Israel to anoint. They were all prayed before him, and he found none that were worthy because David was out working in the field. So this is what is said. But the Lord God said to Samuel, again, this is the Lord God, all capital L, this is that Jehovah again. Look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. This is the last thing he looked at before he went to pick David. For the Lord seeth not as a man sees, for man looketh at the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh into the heart. And you need to say amen to that.
Amen.
Reason why you will not be judged about this outward flesh that we have been given, that you had no choice. Did anyone get to vote they were going to be a particular color or height or weight? No one does. No one controls that. That is what you were given into, this flesh that you have. But you can interface with your spirit with God. And amen and hallelujah to that. God is not, Peter points out in 1 Peter 1:17. And if you call on the Father, if you call on the name of the Lord, who without respect of persons, that doesn't mean he doesn't respect us. That means there's no favorites played. God does not pay favorites because you're a rich kid, or you're a poor kid, or you're black or white or pink or purple or fat or thin. He does not care. He cares about what you are on the inside. And it says, every man's, and judgeth according to every man's own work. He is not judging your works on whether they're good or not. He's judging your works on whether they were done in the name of God with the righteous hearts after you were sealed with Jesus Christ. That's what he's talking about here. Past the time of your sojourning here in life. Well, you're in fear. So notice here we see the word fear. We are working out our salvation in fear. Now, this is not the fear, you know, we saw that Adam once said he was afraid. This is a fear of reverence. Like we heard earlier, fathers sometimes take an interest in your behind. They get a belt out once in a while and they work them out some of your sins so that you're a little more appreciative and pure. I know that my father took the belt after me less often than he should have. I remember one time he went out and I was hoping his speech wouldn't be long because I had said a word that I never should have said, and with every stroke it's like, don't you ever do that again. And I'm like, speed it up, But that's the reverent fear we're talking about. Yes, you heard the old phrase, I've put you into this world, I can take you out. God really can. God really can. He will judge you. And he has the right to judge you. And he will righteously judge you. Why? Because he is alone is righteous. He judges everything against himself and he's 100% pure good. So when he says you're good, you're really good. But when he says you're out of line, you're out of line. And he gives us the Bible to do that. Okay, moving along. The Apostle Paul also talked about this as well. The mankind and the state of mankind. He says this in Acts 17, 26 and 27. And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth. That's everybody. Does anyone read anything different into that? That's everybody. Everybody on the face of the earth is one blood. And hath determined the times before appointed and the boundaries of their habitation. He knows where you're going to live. He knows exactly if you're going to move, you're going to be here tomorrow. And he's talking whole nations that way. So God is in control. And we're all of his blood. And that blood is the same bloodline that came from Adam, that came from Noah, We are all these children of Adam. Now, why did God do this? Why did he make us all of one blood? And why does he put us together? And often in these boundaries that mankind has, we have conflict. We are hitting each other with various, you know, do you get along with your neighbor all the time? You try to, but nations have conflicts. And in that conflict, oftentimes you are in a position where you need the Lord. If everything went well in your life and everything was fat and happy, how many people would call upon the name of the Lord? It's stress that often gets people to call on the name of the Lord. And that's why they have these boundaries, and that's why these conflicts happen in this habitation. Why is that? That they should seek the Lord, that they might feel apprehended. If you look at the words in the Greek, it says grope in the dark. You're groping in the dark. You're in a dark place and you're reaching out trying to find it. And God is there when you do. So that is the great equalizer. That is the same condition all mankind is born into. By the way, and this comes up, have you ever heard of critical race theory?
Oh, no.
Okay, if you haven't, you will, because this is being pushed at us. And I would say, to me, this is an insulting thing as a Christian. Because mankind, according to the Bible, is one flesh. And we are all equal. We're all equally wicked sinners before a holy God. And we're in the same dire position and we all need a Savior. There is no color out there that is any more predominant than any other in the eyes of God. We are all equal. Again, God does not look at the outward appearance. He looks at the hearts. And hallelujah, amen to that. Okay, with that as our underpinning. Fallen mankind, spiritually naked but unafraid. Unfortunately, this is the position we find much of the world in. As children of Adam, and we're all children of Adam, we just established that, we are all born spiritually naked and separated from God. Many souls in their rebellion have lost all the fear that they should have for the Lord God. The wickedness we find in Genesis before the flood is repeated again and again and again in the Old Testament, and we're seeing it repeated again today in the world. Genesis 6:5-6 says that God saw that the wickedness of man was great in earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart, again, God judges the heart, was only evil continually. Can you imagine that? Every thought in your mind is evil. That's where they were in the state in relationship to God. And it repented God, which means God kind of he had changed his thoughts. Should I have created man? That he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him in his heart. That's a sad thing to think about, but you can grieve the Holy Spirit. You can grieve the heart of God. Why? Jeremiah 8:12 gives us an inkling of how bad it is. Were they ashamed? And there's that word, you know, shame again. It's popping up again. Were they ashamed when they committed abominations? And we're talking about the people of Israel. These are the, you know, apple of God's eye. This is at the time where the kingdom of Israel had already been destroyed by Assyria, and there were just a couple of tribes left that were living down in the Jerusalem, Judah area. And these were the holy people of God that God had gave the law and the prophets to. And what had they done with it? If you go back and read Jeremiah, you will find out that they, in this house of God, where we worship God, Jesus Christ, they would set up, like today's example, they would have a shrine of Buddha over here. They would have a shrine for the Muslim faith over here. They would have an animalistic worship service over here. Inside the temple of God, built by Solomon, they were sacrificing to other gods. They were worshiping other gods. It's amazing to consider that. Now, if you and I went to a church and they were having that in the same sanctuary that we were worshiping our God, would we stand for it? I hope not. There is one path to God. Is that correct? Is that what Christianity teaches?
Yes.
I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except through the Son, right? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay, so we don't allow that in our worship service. These people were, and they were encouraging others to do the same. That's why Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, had to write this to them. His soul was grieving as he wrote these words. Were they ashamed when they were committing abominations? Nay, they were not at all ashamed. Neither could they blush. Therefore shall they fall among them that fall in the time of their visitation. They shall be cast down, saith the Lord. Now, Adam and Eve were cast out of the Garden of Eden. These people would be cast down. Same way with those people that were living at the time of Noah. They were all cast down. Their flesh was utterly destroyed, and they were cleansed off the face of the earth. The same thing happened to the nation of Judah, the apple of God's eye. They were cleansed and removed from the holy land that was promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Israel. People had built not only physical idols that they were worshiping, they had also built within their heart, and this should scare the hell out of everyone in here. You better check your heart. Because we read that they were having idols in their hearts as well. Are you building an idol in your heart? Is there something you're putting before God? Well, need to do a check, my brothers and sisters in Christ. See where you're at. Because that's what ended up destroying these people. Now, switching topics. We're moving right along into the gospel. And again, our topic is naked and afraid. Now, how many of you have had dreams where you were in public naked? It's a common thing. Why? Why is it common? Because when you're out there totally exposed. People see you for who you are. Now, that dream is so common that you can go look it online and everyone's got one. But you are there exposed and everyone sees you. There's nowhere to hide. There's nowhere to go. They see you in all your nakedness. But it is also, in the same vein, spiritual. God alone can see you in your spiritual nakedness. That's a scary thought for most of us. Let me ask you this one. Have you ever had an evil thought before? Come on, if not, you're lying. You're guilty of lying then. So we've all had them. Everyone has evil thoughts. Every once in a while I'm driving my car and it's like, just like a slam into that guy. Help me, Lord. So it's human. It's human. Okay? But again, it's there. Now, all those nasty thoughts and all those sins that you have ever had, I want you to think about someone that's never had one. Someone that has never had an evil thought in his mind. Someone that has never done an evil act in their life. Someone that is pure and righteous from the time they were born. That's who Jesus Christ is. He was the perfect Lamb of God without blemish. And it was determined by the Godhead before the foundation of the world that the means by which every one of you would be cleansed is through the Son of God becoming incarnate in the flesh and being raised up as the Son of Man. And that's the name he uses for himself above all other names that he chooses. He calls himself the Son of Man. Why? Because he is living amongst man in the flesh. He is living amongst man in the spirit. He is seeing all the temptations and frustrations that life throws at you. But here he is. In John 12:27, he says the following. Because he knows what's coming. We said today in our Bible study, oh, thank goodness that we don't know when we're going to die. Because it would be terrible to know when that thing is, because it would always be pressing on you and pressing on you. Listen to Jesus' word here in John 12:27. Now my heart is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from the hour. No, it was for this reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Now is the time of the judgment of this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And through this act that we're going to be discussing about momentarily is how Satan will start being driven out of this world. It's not going to happen all at once, because it's a slow, gradual process. And thank you, Lord, because we have that opportunity before us today because of this sacrifice he has done. In 32, but I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to me. And I see that being fulfilled in two ways. One, when he's lifted up on the cross. And two, when he's going to be lifting up and sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty in heaven. Amen. Amen. Luke 22:44. Don't anybody tell me that Jesus had an easy time of it. He had this burden on him like none of us ever had. He not only had, you know, whatever he was dealing with. He knew physically what he was going to endure. But he knew on the back, he was carrying everyone's sin. Yours. Everything you've ever done. He was taking that with him. Listen to the agony that's being portrayed here. Here he is. This is the night before, the night he's betrayed. He's at the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's alone. And the disciples fell asleep. And he was by himself. Listen to these words. In being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly. Now, you'd think that Jesus' prayers were enough, wouldn't you? You'd think he has to pray earnestly. But he was such a state here that he felt compelled to say prayers even more earnestly. And his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Wow. Wow. And he's doing that. In Matthew 27:27, this is the day that he's already been through all these courts and they have determined that he is guilty. And soldiers at the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered together onto him a whole band of soldiers. And they stripped him down and put him in the scarlet robe. And they mocked him. And he was beaten. And he was thrashed. And chunks of his body were torn flesh as they whipped him. And then he was made to carry his cross. Now, I don't know what you know about the Roman execution of the crucifixion. But it was designed to shame and humiliate and punish the vilest offenders that they had. They saved this for the ones to humiliate the most. As they walked up there after he had been bleeding and his body was tattered, chunks of flesh were hanging off of him. I don't know how he endured to that point, but he was there. Then to add humiliation, Romans typically stripped them naked. And then they hung him, nailed him to a cross. Now I read some commentary said, oh, they, out of modesty, they would have left a loincloth. Maybe they did. But it would be strange for the Romans to do that. Especially on one like Jesus Christ, who they wanted to humiliate. Who they wanted to drag down. Satan, I'm sure, was doing his best to humiliate Christ. And he had the Roman soldiers there to do that. So it would be an exception to their policy. But here he is, Jesus. We already know he's afraid. Because we have looked at this. He's a human like you and I. He's going to be afraid. And he's stripped naked and humiliated. And he's enduring all that for you. Thank you, Lord. All right. Now, that was the low point of today's topic. Now, let's lift us up. Because Christ will be lifted up. Christ is physically risen and spiritually triumphant and covers and clothes us. He is the solution to the problem that was generated when Adam and Eve took the bite of that forbidden fruit and became spiritually naked before God. There can be reconciliation now. 1 Corinthians 15:22 says, "For as in Adam all died," and that's what we're born, right? We're all born spiritually separated from God. We are all dead in our sins. And that's the way we start out life. "Even so, in Christ shall all be made alive." Amen.
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 Now, there's a little word there, in Christ. You have to be in Christ shall all be made alive again. Now, that does not mean universal salvation. Don't get me wrong. There is a commitment required on our parts in order for us to be able to be considered in Christ. We must believe. 45. "And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. And that last Adam is Jesus Christ. And because he lives, we can live." Isaiah saw this coming long, long before, 800 years beforehand, when he said the following, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord," and there's that Jehovah again, the great I am, Jesus Christ. "My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation and hath covered me with the robe of righteousness." And that is the only way we can ever be considered righteous before God. The only way is through the blood. When Christ was on that cross, his blood dripped down and covered all future generations of those people who would believe. Man, I'm giving so many amens, I hate to keep giving them, but give me an amen on that one too. I mean, this is good stuff. This is good news. It doesn't get any better than this. 2 Corinthians 5:2. "Meanwhile, we groan." Anybody groaning out there? I'm groaning. When I see everything that's going around in the world out there, I'm groaning. It's hurting. It's hurting my spirit to see these things. And I'm longing, and I'm going to continue here, longing to be clothed with that heavenly dwelling. Come, Lord Jesus. Because when we are clothed, we are not found naked. And amen. That is the only way that we can be spiritually covered, is through Christ. Otherwise, we stand naked before God, exposed with all the nastiness of our inner beings being seen by Him. And thank goodness that you can't see all the nastiness stuff in me, because I'm up here preaching, but if you saw what was going on inside me, you'd probably get up out the door and walk. You'd probably turn to somebody next to you and say, "Well, I wouldn't want to be here either if you know all their thoughts." There's nobody out there that is without sin. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now here's the big question of the day. Now I know you are my brothers and sisters in Christ, but I can't look inside anyone's heart. There's only one person that has ever lived on this face of the earth and walked, and his name was called the Son of Man. And he was also called the Son of God. Now this Son of God came down, like I said, and dwelt among us. Was crucified, raised on the third day, and now he ascended at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And he's there, intervening for us in hearing our prayers and petitions. But the last pieces of information he gave to us are in Revelation. So I said we're going to start in Genesis and we're going to go to Revelation. So we're in Revelation now. And he went and saw seven churches he visited. He in his presence went down and he walked among the churches and he gave each of them a message. There are two churches I want to talk about. Many people believe that these are the last two churches that will appear at the end of the church age. And that's what we're living in right now. We live in the church age. The church age began at Pentecost, and the church age will end when Jesus Christ returns in the rapture for his church, his bride. If you are a member of his church, you will be lifted up. Give me an amen on that.
Amen.
You will be lifted up to meet the Lord in the air, and you will dwell in these houses and mansions that he had made for us in eternity. Well, that's a wonderful thought. That's why that is called, the rapture is called the blessed hope. It is just when we meet the Lord face to face. That's going to be an amazing time. Anyway, there's two churches I want to talk about. These are the last two churches that many people believe that are existing on the face of the earth right now. One of them is the Church of Philadelphia, and that means the Church of Brotherly Love. Now, you might not know it if you ever go visit Philadelphia in the United States. Don't think that is the impression of what it's going to be like. Yeah, but we're talking about this church. And we talked about in Revelation 3:5, he that overcome, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels.
Amen.
Now, how do you overcome? Is a question I have. How do you overcome? Everybody know?
Believe so.
The only way that you can overcome is through Jesus Christ, who has overcome the world. And because Jesus Christ overcome the world, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you too will overcome, and all these things shall come to you. You'll be clothed in white raiment. Though your sins will be as scarlet, they'll be as white as snow. Your sins will be taken as far as from the east to the west. No more will those evil, nasty, vile things you say and do and think will be held against you. Because when you are presented in front of the holy God, guess who they see instead of you? Jesus Christ, and his blood has washed you clean. He is the only means by which that can be done. There is no other option B. It's option A. Well, there is an option B. Let's see what option B is if you're presented before God. This is the church of Laodicea. This is in Revelation 3:17. This is the opposite end of the spectrum. You want to be in the church of Philadelphia. You do not want to be in the church of the Laodiceans. Let me read this. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I will spew you out of my mouth. And if you look up that word, it means vomit. Now, do you think God has a high opinion of you if he vomits you out of his mouth? I wouldn't want to be there. I'll take that option A. Put me back over in that church of Philadelphia. I counsel thee. Now look at what, these are Jesus Christ's words here. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that refiner's fire that we have spoken of, the trials of life, which bring you out and make you know that you are beholding to something else. There's something out there greater than you, that you mayest be rich, and white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame, there's that word shame again, of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. Because if you don't see this, you're blind. You're blinded. You're walking around the earth. Here's your condition. You are spiritually dead. You are spiritually blind. You are spiritually naked. You could not perceive truth if it came up and slapped you in the face. And that truth is the gospel. You have to be able to understand this to approach God. And here is what the problem is. The problem is we find Revelation 14. We started in Genesis. And we're going to end here with this verse. Now in this verse, this is an amazing verse, because this is the final message that God gives mankind before he comes back and purges the earth like he did in the Genesis flood. He purges the earth again, but this at the end of the 7-year tribulation period. And this is what he tells this angel to go out and pronounce over the whole world this message. And he then said in a loud voice, fear God. Isn't that interesting? You have many churches that tell you, oh, you know, God is not a God of fear. He's a God of love. And is Jesus Christ the God of love? Absolutely. But you have not read the Bible if you don't understand there's judgment as well. You must understand that God is not limited in His nature to just be love. Now, He expects us to be in love and do love to everyone else. Because our judgment is flawed. Always flawed. We cannot judge. We're the who. You ever see those guys, serial murder comes on and he's killed 20 people and the neighbor next to him, he's such a nice boy. You go, what? We can't judge inside because we can't see inside anybody. God can. So we shouldn't judge and we should be in love with each other. But we should know in reverent fear of God that He exists. Why do you think Adam was afraid? He was naked and afraid, so he feared. So the step one in a relationship with God is acknowledging who you are in relationship to God. And I know this is disappointing to some people in the world, but you're not God. Nor can you say God doesn't exist. You don't have that power. Okay? And give Him the glory. They know who He is. Give Him the glory because the hour of His judgment is come. A lot of people say, oh, judgment's not really coming. No, that's just an old tale from the desert, nomads, and it's coming. No, go read the whole Bible, and then you tell me that God is not coming in judgment at the end of the age. He is. And if you don't know where to look, come to me. I can point it out. Worship Him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of the water. My brothers and sisters in Christ, if you are that person who is not yet committed to God, or if you are that person who has a burden that you think God cannot see into the core of your being, you need to come clean. Now, you might not do it at this altar. You might want to do it at that place at home where you commune with God. But you need to come clean if you're carrying around sins in your life right now. And if you have not made that commitment to Jesus Christ, this is the time to do it. Nobody is guaranteed anything in this life. God knows exactly when you're going to die. Beyond that, you have no clue. Clueless. So if you're waiting and waiting and waiting for the right time, now's the right time if you have not committed to God. So we're going to sing a song here in a bit. And if you want to come up to the altar, talk to God. I can't help you out. God can. He can see into your heart and He can present it to you. And what happens is wonderful after this. Bear with me for a minute. When you believe with a sincere heart to God, call on the name of the Lord, He will listen. He is there. He is waiting for that knock from you, and He will enter in. And when He enters in, you will be saved for eternity. Your name will be in that Lamb's Book of Life. You will be clothed in white raiment. Your name will not be blotted out anymore. And He will confess your name before the Father as a vouchsafe. He is going to guarantee that for you. And how wonderful that is. How wonderful. So, let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are not ashamed before You because You have covered us. Lord, You have covered all our sins and You have sacrificed Yourself for us. And Lord, we're thankful for that. We in no way deserve any of the grace that You have given to us and showered us with. But Lord, we are ever thankful for Your grace, Your mercy, Your love, and tenderness. Lord, use us as Your vessels. Pour us out to others that we know. Let us reach them with Your word. And if we have a soul out there that is yearning to have that personal relationship with You, You come forward. This is Your time. God is ready for you. He's worked in your life, and now is the time for you to respond in faith. For He loves us, and He wants to enter into that bond with you. In the name of
Jesus Christ, the author of our salvation, we pray. Amen. Amen.